Welcome, welcome, welcome. The doorbell continues to ring. It is so nice to see so many beautiful, shiny, smiley faces today. Hello, Galen. It's great to see your face on here. You guys can turn your video on if you want. I honestly don't mind, but be aware that if you turn your video on, everyone's going to see you, and I'm okay with that, but maybe some of you aren't. Please do remember you are brought in on mute, but if for whatever reason you take yourself off mute, feel free to put yourself back on mute. But the chat is open, so come on in. Hello. Yeah, hello from everybody. Go ahead and let people know who you are, where are you calling from. Even feel free to say like kind of what your company is today. We're going to let a couple more people into this room. This has been an incredibly fantastic and well-attended session. Let's just mute. Please make sure that you are on mute when you enter the room. Please don't take yourself off mute because it will create a little bit of back feedback for me. We're just gonna give it another second here because the doorbell keeps on ringing. Hello, Blaine. Hello, Travis. Hello, Guilam. It is great to see all of you, or at least see your faces, your voices, your names appear on here. And welcome. Today, we're gonna be focusing on the reasons to reach out when you're not too sure if now's the time to call. Really relevant topic, wouldn't you think? It was actually inspired from some students that I teach. So I teach a few different classes, as well as my team does teach a few different classes as well. And as we kind of congregated and decided, you know, what are some of the topics that are very relevant to our students and to our classes? This one came up like immediately. It was like, people are afraid to reach out. Can we make it an opportunity for them to be able to go on? Thanks, Natalie. Yeah, please let people know who you are, where you're calling from, what is your business? Because why not? Why not? And so we were having this topic. So last week we held a 4-hour training session for those of you that were able to make it for a portion of it or part of it. And it was just about how do we reach out. Today I want to focus a little bit on what are some of the reasons, other opportunities that we can reach out. We've upped our webinar series. So typically we do a webinar once a month. For the next little while, we're going to be doing them once every 2 weeks. And we are going to host weekly sales role play sessions for you as part of our give back. We want you to be comfortable having these conversations, comfortable reaching out to clients as you go forward. The doorbell might keep on ringing for a little bit. Because as people kind of come in, and we're just going to kind of put that off to the side, but let's get started today. So these are recorded in the event that you do have to jump off. But I do recommend sticking around for as long as you possibly can, because it's always valuable. And if you do have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat. The chat is available to you. And if we have time, I will answer them. Otherwise, I will save some time at the very end to be able to address any chat conversations. So what is your client going through? If we're going to reach out to somebody, let's have an understanding about what they're going through first. So before any phone call or email, I want you to ask yourself, like, what could my client be concerned with? So last week I did a blog post on LinkedIn, and it was really covering about, you know, understanding, like, why do we want to call? What are some of the indications that our clients are going to call? And it talked about, like, you know, just using compassion first, right? You know, stand in the feet of your clients. Understand, like, if I was my client, like, what might be some of the things that I'm going through. And this is going to vary from client to client. I mean, you know, we could talk about restaurants, you know, restaurants where maybe most or all of their business is completely shrunk down. But if your clients are like retail environments, like grocery stores, I mean, they're busier than they've ever been, right? We could talk about, you know, how maybe accounting firms are ridiculously busy right now, because they're getting tons of questions from their clients about what are some of the tax benefits that are available to me? What are some of the legal ramifications of about, you know, changing, you know, wage subsidies or putting my clients on EI versus something else, employment insurance or putting them on unemployment insurance, whatever that is. So there's a ton of different industries. Some people are going to be really busy. Some people are going to be, you know, really slow, but we need to enter from a place of empathy. Whatever that is, more than likely, people are just stressed. We are at our capacity. So if you are going to reach out in a way that is not self-centered, but rather selfless. How can you go ahead and help your clients? But don't assume that every single client is that you're going to call is going to enter in and be like, ah, what are you doing? Why are you calling me? I was watching LinkedIn and there was a gentleman on there. He calls himself a sales thought leader. And I thought this was a terrible posting for him to do because he basically publicly bashed this company for reaching out to them and saying like, hey, what are your goals, you know, for 2020? And I get it. You know, sometimes we don't really know what to say. So we might just start by saying what we're already been saying. Like if this has already worked, maybe it'll continue to work. But instead of publicly bashing this client like he did, I said like, you know, maybe just assume that they're a little bit confused just like everybody else. He went on about complaining that the person was like, you know, tone deaf and this is terrible. And he posted his whole response. But here's the thing is that that was me. I would not want to be treated that way. If I was one of his clients, I would not want to like approach him and like, you know, assume that what if this was my company? What if this is like, you know, how he also treats other companies? So at the end of the day, the golden rule applies. Just treat people how you want to be treated. And we're going to talk about a lot of different optimistic and positive ways that we can reach out to people. Because what you may know about me, if you've been following me for a while, is that I don't come from the old school thought of sales where it's like, you know, all around, you know, fear mongering and letting people be pessimistic. I actually come from an opposite side. I want to be optimistic and hopeful. And I think that's more so what more people want as opposed to anything else. So the big thing is that, you know, are our clients looking to survive or are they looking to thrive? So as I was putting together this webinar, I started to do a lot of research and I was asking like what was going on. And I found this one great article by Harvard Business Review. I think I might have posted it on LinkedIn on our KO Advantage group page. If it's not posted yet, it's going to be posted up fairly soon. So don't forget to follow them. But HBR, Harvard Business Review, did a study of 40 years versus recessions. And found that companies who grew did two things. They reduced inefficient operating spend. So the thing you need to ask yourself is, does my product or service help companies to reduce inefficient operating expenses? Am I going to help my companies save money? And I have my own thoughts about when it comes to like saying that you're going to be saving people money. Or am I going ahead and I'm actually going to help my companies to grow? Companies who help their companies to grow are those that, you know, ultimately are there to help increase efforts in research and development, sales and marketing. So is your company going to help your customers grow their expenses? You know, are you going to help them to not just necessarily increase research and development, but increase it in a meaningful way that's going to help them? Are you going to help them gain more clients? Are you going to help them gain more exposure? Or is that ultimately going to translate in more dollars in the pocket? And that is ultimately, regardless of where you are, I have always wanted my students to focus on is how are you going to help me make more money? And we're going to talk about that a little bit later on today's webinar. But the biggest thing is how are you going to help your company, your clients to grow? Because if you are there just to say, I'm going to help you save money, I'm going to help you save money, I'm going to help you save money, that might work for a short period of time. But what is ultimately going to happen is your client is going to be like, okay, great, until the next person comes in and just helps me save money. So we want to move the conversation away from how are we going to help you potentially save money if that's what you focus on, so that the company can go ahead and reinvest that into a way that they're going to help make more money. Help me increase my growth. Help me increase my revenue. Help me increase my profitability so that then I can go ahead and see at things at different levels. So my sales background, for those of you who have known, I've actually worked through various difficult times. The Great Recession of 2008, 2009, or whatever you want to call it. In that period of time, when the markets started to tank and everybody grabbed their money and they held onto it as quickly as they could and said, I am not spending a dime, I was still able to become Rep of the Year by focusing on helping clients make more money. This is why it's so critical, because a lot of people out there, your competitors out there, a lot of other businesses out there are all going to talk about, how am I going to help you save money? I need you to take that step further. If you are going to help somebody save money, it is to save money so that they can then reinvest this. Yes, this might mean one or two extra meetings with a client, but I promise you, they are going to invest more with you because you are so future focused. Another time that I end up having to face this was in 2015. So I live in a society where oil and gas kind of runs majority of the economy. And in 2015, oil prices continued to tank to the lowest that they ever could. A lot of companies were, yet again, our revenues are shrinking. We need to go ahead. We need to reduce spend. We need to reduce our costs. And they would call us and they would typically say, how can you help us reduce our spend? And here's the thing, is that if as a company, we are not in a position to just go ahead and reduce spend for every single company that asks. So instead of that, we said, well, we can do this and maybe we take a look at other opportunities in your business. Maybe there are other inefficiencies that we can help you improve. This wasn't just looking at our product and service offering. This was looking at their entire book of business. This was looking at the entire global scheme of how they were running through various transactions. Because the way that our company would typically move is that we wouldn't just impact one single line of business. Yes, we would, but how it also impacted other lines of business were areas that we also wanted to focus on. So we would do this in exchange for, listen, we're happy to help you look at how we can reduce your spend in this area with the expectation that we take a look at other areas. How is your procurement team currently procuring? How much time are they spending on this? How much are your operating individuals spending on doing this type of process? Or how long are they spending, you know, or how much money are they spending in these other areas? Can we consolidate all of this and hopefully increase our overall opportunities? Yet again, I became the top rec by working with my clients on creating solutions for them. We would look at things in brand new lenses. Always say yes to a meeting first. If the client is just calling you to reduce their spend, yes, and how can we take a look at this? Now, I'm not saying yes is always going to be the answer, but it's like, listen, I'm happy to take a look at this. I can't make you any promises at this point in time. And how can we take a look at this? Because this is obviously something very important to you. Beyond those big global events, I also had to deal with very significant smaller events, clients that went bankrupt, deaths that they would have. Like one time I had a client whose business partner actually ended up passing away. That was a very sensitive topic that we ended up having to deal with. And it wasn't that we shied away from it, but we saw this as an opportunity to take a look at creating better relationships with our clients, relationships first all the time. And other companies that had to deal with mass layoffs, which also became a very sensitive topic. How do you deal with this? Do you choose to tiptoe around it, or do you just face it and say, this is how it is? How do we use this as an opportunity? My company today, we essentially provide Fortune 500 level sales training without those Fortune 500 companies. What we ultimately do is we help our clients get more sleep, knowing where their deals are coming from, how much money, when are they going to close, what are the opportunities going to look like, and how do we ensure that this is going to be consistent in months in advance, because today is the day that we focus on the deals, not just the ones that are going to close in March. Yes, that's really important, but how do we ensure that we're planting the seeds for April, May, June, and beyond? We also give our clients more empowerment to say no earlier and move on. Here's the thing, especially right now, this is going to be a great opportunity for companies to go ahead and get rid of the dead weight. Maybe the employees, the offices, the facilities that just aren't working for them anymore. And it's going to give them an opportunity to look better at their relationships, be able to connect more with the clients that they want to, and create stronger partnerships. You're going to feel that the people that are going to surround you are meant to be there, not outside of that. So let's talk about the various ways that you can now approach your clients and prospects in ways that are meaningful for them. I hope you have a pen and paper. This is recorded and we will have an opportunity to share some of the slide decks later, but I want you to take as many notes as possible and ask yourself, who can I think of immediately? Who is that client that I can think of immediately that meets that particular topic? Or how can I use this in my own business to start leveraging these points and create even more opportunity, right? So the first thing I want you to focus on is that no one ever complained about being overserved. Right now, more companies are pulling themselves back. I saw another blog post from another quote unquote sales leader that was out there. And he said that his big thing was he told his entire team to stop prospecting. Oh, I almost had a heart attack. I'm like, how do you tell people to stop prospecting? I get if your prospecting involves like, hey, do you need our services today or now or in the future? But if that was your opportunity or that's the way you were prospecting, yes, definitely stop. You should have stopped years ago, but definitely today is the day that you stop. Our prospecting should be about how do we serve? How do we connect? How do we create opportunity? And if you're working with either current clients or future opportunities, how do you go ahead and serve them? So there's better way. So one of the ways is to find out what are some of the ways that your clients are currently using old tools or some of the tools that they already are. This is really specific to people that are already using your services. Have you been able to update them on some of the changes in the past, the improvements or ways that your clients have been using your products in new and unique ways? When I worked in medical sales, we would typically connect with our clients and ask them, how have you used this in a way that we haven't thought about? What is an indication or what is a client, a patient that came into you and asked for a type of service? How are you able to use this? And we would become essentially hubs of this type of information. Perhaps you've made improvements in your service capabilities or in your product. And yes, you may have rolled these out, but at the time, maybe your client was just too busy to take a look at this or to leverage it for what it was ultimately used for. The quickest way of being able to do this is if you're using a customer relationship management tool in a very valuable way, filter by product lines. See who is using the full suite of your products and who isn't, and start reaching out to those clients and not just talk about, are you using a product line B when you're also using product line A, but rather ask them, did you know by using these two things together, you have the opportunity to save more time, save more money, make more money, make more profit, whatever it is. Always go with the highest value first. And the highest value first is how do I help you make more money or more profit? If you can't connect the dots the entire way, then go into the saving time or saving money. But help your clients feel educated first and foremost. Let me show you how we can ultimately do this. And maybe this includes you also hosting personalized training sessions. Maybe in the past, you would go ahead and host a giant webinar. Listen, we just launched a new product or feature set. We're going to be hosting a webinar to show you how to use this. At this point in time, people are wanting more personal attention. We're getting lonely. And for those of you that are in places that are living by social distancing, this is more so when you're dealing with social distancing, this is more so that we're actually now craving personalized attention. The amount of articles that are coming out right now that have to deal with clients that are going ahead and saying, listen, where the phone call is back. This is unbelievable. We had a question from Lynn who's asking, how do we deal when we're dealing with startups? Lynn, I promise you, I will get there. I want to start off with the low hanging fruit first, which is how do we connect more with our current clients? And then as we go through there, how do we connect with prospects going forward? So thank you so much for your question. But this also can give you an opportunity to not just teach, but also facilitate. Training sessions don't necessarily have to be in this webinar type of format. Training sessions can be done very easily by creating a list of questions that we want to cover. How is this department versus this department using that service capability? How is this company versus this company using those service capabilities? By creating much more of a facilitation, you're not responsible for having to have all the answers. answers, but allowing the group conversation to take over. I promise you, you will come up with more ideas that way than if you are there just talking about what those valuable questions were. Valuable questions can create conversation starters. And for those of you that are in KO sales, you know how much we promote valuable questions. Think about the questions that maybe you typically ask in a sales cycle and use those as your conversation starters for both either current clients or people that aren't using your services right now. And those training sessions don't necessarily have to be around your particular product or service. Maybe there's other ways that you also impact people. Maybe this is also ways of how are you using your current accounting services? How are you currently using your cash flow services? What is the two or three steps that happen either before or after somebody is using your services? And how do you promote those conversations going forward? Because you can be proactive in this way. What might your client need that they haven't asked for? Right now, we're talking a lot more about cleaning, sanitizing, taking care of solutions, being able to make sure everything is completely clean. If that is a service that you already offer, that is a great thing. But maybe you're in technology, right? We could be talking about cleaning physical surfaces, but maybe this is also an opportunity as an IT company to talk about, when was the last time we cleaned up your files? When was the last time we cleaned up your inbox, your other documentation with us, your reporting, making sure that the reporting is the right conversation that you need to do. Just because you've been using the exact same report for the last 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, doesn't mean that it's still relevant. So how do we use this in a much more meaningful way? Is it perhaps you have an increased level of service? Maybe you want to provide more, maybe much more of a hands-on or an individualized service. Maybe you want to reach out to somebody with different payment terms, being proactive in types of payments. Not that we want to reduce our cash flow by any means, but sometimes it is more valuable to approach people. I saw on Facebook not too long ago, a gentleman who had posted a screenshot of one of his vendors who said the vendor reached out and said, listen, I know right now in particular your business is going into hard times. His business was in particular an event space. So events have been completely canceled. And he's like, I know your business is running into some challenging times right now. Listen, for now, what we're going to do is we're going to delay your next payment until May or April or whatever. And the gentleman was like, so grateful. Do you think that creates a client for life? Absolutely. Or other types of flexibility. Maybe this means servicing people outside of typical business hours. Maybe this means that you're approaching people outside of what would also be what you would have considered. But this can be a great opportunity to reach out. But however you reach out, make sure you are coming not just with what you think is the client's problem or what their challenge is, but also a very particular solution. Be specific in your solution or the approach that you want. Not just saying, hey, we're here to help. Hey, listen, customer, if you need additional payment terms or you need us to service outside of normal business hours, just let us know what you need. That is not specific. What I want to say is, listen, some of our clients have asked us to service after 6 p.m. when their doors are closed. If that is something that you would like us to do, we're more than happy to maybe book your next servicing appointment on Thursday. That is much more specific, and it allows the client to say yes. It allows them to say, that is what I need. Okay. So servicing other clients. Let's talk about communities. Community equal to economies. I actually stole this particular slide from an economist here, or one of our local economists for one of our big banks. He actually put this as his slide pre-COVID. It was actually a session that we sat in and talking about what the opportunities for 2020 were going to look like. This was back in, I was going to say April, but we're not even in April yet. How the year has already flown by. I think it was back in like late January or early, I sat in on his session and I said, I love this. Communities equal economies. Let's talk about creating communities little economy. How do you connect with your clients and industries? So if you are in a particular industry, are you connecting with others inside that industry to ultimately leverage? Or if you specialize servicing a special industry, how are you connecting others inside that industry? This is like ultimately the hub and spokes idea. Can you become the central hub with all of the spokes? If you're fortunate enough to work with clients that maybe are in various geographies or are in, whether they're in competitive or non-competitive environments, perhaps they service the exact same type of clients, but they're in other locations or other geographies or slightly different. This can be a great opportunity to connect other clients in other ways. So how do you create more collaboration and that same type of facilitation? Use technology to your advantage. So virtual happy hours, virtual opportunities for a conversation. Don't think that this has to be completely facilitated. My sound. The bigger the conversations that you ultimately have with this, the bigger it can be. So, the bigger the conversations that you have, the shorter number of topics that you need to cover is what I wanted to get to. So let's say you bring in an environment of 30 people, you may only have time to cover one or two questions or topics. If you are creating a smaller or more intimate environment, which is also super valuable, you might have the to cover closer to 5 or 6 topics in an hour. So create these talking points as opposed to thinking what I'm wanting to create. In our ways and how we're doing this is that we're creating the sales role play, weekly sales role play sessions, where we're bringing in clients, we're bringing in industries to ultimately help them in other ways. Think of yourself as also creating a partnership or panels. So else is targeting a similar client base. In my business, this would be other marketing agencies or other companies that are also approaching people. We're connecting on the same types of clients, but we're not competitive. So maybe I can create a panel for my clients to say, this is really interesting. I'm him and her team together. Maybe this is where you're bringing in other businesses, maybe other restaurants, maybe you're bringing in other financial institutions, maybe you're bringing in other IT firms, whatever it is. But find out who else is targeting that same client base. This is a great opportunity to prospect in a non-salesy way. Because if you're bringing together this panel and we urge the panel to share with their connections, their other client bases, they're going to be bringing in them for this webinar or for this virtual panel. And this can ultimately create some thought leadership. You can use other types of technology, such as I use Otter.ai, Otter, and I'll write this actually in the chat here right now. It actually allows it to auto-transcribe every single one of my... My sound keeps going off here. Okay, can you still hear me? Hopefully you can. Okay, thank you. So I can't hear it, but you guys can. So that's all good then. When you go ahead and you create that thought leadership, right, when using something like Otter.ai, what it automatically does is it actually transcribes the conference, the Zoom links that you've actually created, which then allows you to not only use it as a live content, right? Perhaps you're doing this through LinkedIn Live, Facebook Live, or even just recording it through just a Zoom conversation, but then you can go ahead and have it automatically transcribed, allowing it then to become a blog post, allowing it to become other types of content, allowing it to become speaking topics in order to encourage regularly. Think about it, maybe even you can create this as a regular panel and invite other people going forward. Okay. So celebrate your network is kind of the next idea. So if you have current clients or you have clients that have worked with you in other areas in the past, okay, and I'm going to talk about this one in a second here. Why do your clients work with you? Why have they chosen to go with you in particular or your company or the type of product or service that you've offered? And this doesn't mean that you only have to focus on where you are currently. Perhaps you had a great working relationship from from a previous role or a previous company. You loved that company. Feel free to reach out to those people, find out just how they're doing and connect and be like, hey, when I was your sales rep or when I did work for this company or when I was with this organization, why did you choose to go with us? Or why did you choose to buy from me in particular? What you'll find from those relationships are these are sometimes the opportunities where people will give you all of this information that you hadn't even thought of in the past. When I first started KO Advantage Group as a sales training company, I was shocked because one of the first clients that we ended up having was a previous client I had back in my Xerox days. And they said, Kim, we loved you when you were working for Xerox. And we always thought to ourselves, if we could have you working for our company, we would do it in a heartbeat. And one of the reasons why we want to continue working with you is because we believe that you're such a valuable person to be able to train others. And we want to hire you. Those are the types of relationships that will continue on. And when I worked for American Express and when I worked for Purelane and all these other companies, I was always amazed by how often I could reach out to previous clients, even outside of my current company, and be able to restart those connections. Because we don't know where people have moved or evolved or exchanged. So feel free to reach out from them. Now, if it's current clients or clients that you're currently working with in your current business, ask them one of the critical questions if you haven't done this already, which was, what was the moment that you decided to use our services? When was the moment that you decided that this was the company that you were going to go for? This was the service that you were going to hire? And I said, like, it's likely well before that proposal meeting. Oh my goodness. Here's the amazing thing. It was more than likely, it was something that you didn't even think about. It was something that you just did because this is just the loving person that you are, the compassionate person that you already are. You just said something, you did something. And that was the moment the client says, I am going to work with you. Now, if you could capture that and bottle that, you would do that for every single client. But the moment that the oftentimes the struggle is that you don't know what that moment was. And by asking somebody or taking the time now to ask those questions can then go ahead and allow you to harness that and use it more for other clients. Another great question to follow up with them on that is, am I still that person or am I still providing you with what you expected? This gives you an opportunity to do better in your life, to be able to serve your clients to a higher degree, because hopefully they're honest with you and they'll say, yeah, you still are, or no, I don't feel like you are, which now says, how can we do better? This now creates that deeper connection. And ultimately what it will end up doing is it will help you further on down the road, eventually get to a point where they're buying more from you. Hopefully, maybe not always, but maybe they'll recommend you. Maybe they'll give you a great testimonial. Maybe they'll give you a great referral. Another great thing is also, what change did they see since they started working with you? Those are the things that we need to start including in our sales stories. And now this is a great opportunity to reach out for the sake of just reaching out. Using this opportunity is, how do we help more clients? So we should go ahead and we should create more content as well on the experiences of others. If you haven't been doing this already, this is a great time to actually start building up your case studies, building up those testimonials or features on your clients. Find out from the clients that you absolutely love why they love working with you. And maybe you just go ahead and you just start doing a really quick blog post. Maybe it's just a quick status update on LinkedIn. Listen, XYZ company has been using our services for the last 6 months, and we want you to know how amazing they are. And if you're looking for accountants in this type of industry, right? Maybe they're an accounting firm. If you're looking for an IT professional, we want to tell you how much we love them as a client, and we know that you will love them as a vendor. Oh my goodness, let's talk about spreading some love. It allows you to tag and celebrate the clients that you love doing business with them. Just take a moment to feature them, put them in the spotlight. The nice thing is they are going to be so honored and so grateful that you took this moment that they're more than likely going to share with others and also help to build your network, help you to build out that opportunity and get those people celebrated as well, right? Maybe start a celebration train
or some other opportunity to be able to reach out. And then when they do share that, you can get back on the phone with them and say, thank you so much. Like we, and they'll be like, no, thank you. Like we really appreciate it. And oh my goodness, now you've already created this great opportunity. The nice thing is you don't even need to do this for your current clients. Maybe you choose to do this for your prospects. Let your prospects know what are some of the reasons why they are amazing or why you'd want to work with them. Now it doesn't have to be like this whole like, you know, kiss the butt type of thing, but rather like, listen, you know, like this IT services company services our companies exceptionally well. And we want to celebrate them in hashtag Austin businesses, right? We want to celebrate, you know, so-and-so, you know, grocery stores because they're, you know, the new frontline businesses, right? Hashtag, you know, in it together, whatever it is, where we can actually celebrate others. And then when they see that post or somebody comments on that post, go ahead and take this opportunity to give them a call and say, you know what? Thank you. I thought this was a great opportunity for us to celebrate you. I would love to know a little bit more about your business. You know, when can be a great time for us to connect or meet or, you know, have a greater conversation. They might say right now, they might say, no, it's not the time. And maybe some point in the future, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. So case studies, great, great opportunity to start building up more content, more information, because case studies are the types of information that will carry on with you for years. And if you aren't doing this as a regular basis, today is the day to start focusing on this. So the biggest thing though, is to make this easy for your client to agree. Ask them if you would like to be featured in this case study. Listen, during this time, we're going to be featuring clients that are currently working with us, clients that we would love to see improve with us, you know, ones that have been with us for a long time, ones that have been with us for a short period of time. And see if you can book this as an interview. Once again, I showed you a little otter.ai, which is a great one because it'll actually separate the different types of people. List out the questions that you want to ask them. Make sure your questions get to quantifiables. Feel free to prepare the person in this interview for what you will be asking them. Some of the things we're going to be asking you is how much time savings you've seen, right? What are some of the quantifiables that you've seen, right? What are some of the ways that you've measured our success in the past? I will ask you to do this so that it gives them an opportunity to prepare. Take the responses, write it out into the story that it needs to be in order for a case study to be impactful, and use the acronym situation, action, and result. Quantify the results. Why did they not want to move forward with you initially? And ensure that that becomes one of the main areas that you focus on. Because if one of your current clients who is now amazing is using either a small number of services or a big number of services of you has decided that they didn't want to move with you initially, get that front and center. Someone else is going to read that and say, those are the same things that I'm concerned with. I can't believe that they're now seeing this type of result. The other nice thing is you don't have to focus on people that are using your entire suite of services. Focus on somebody who's only using on just a particular service. And then by the time you get to the end of the interview, be like, I'm so glad you've been a part of this. Thank you so much. One of the things that came out of other interviews that we've done in the past was how some companies would been able to use that particular suite that you're already using and added this other thing in order to get even more enhancement. I would love to be able to show you an opportunity and how we can create that collaboration. When would be a good time for me to come back? This becomes that, it's called the reciprocal. Robert Cialdini talked about this in Influence, and because now you've given them an opportunity to share their story, they are more likely to say yes to giving you the opportunity to share other areas on how you can improve their business. This doesn't have to be reciprocal in the amount of time that you've taken, but it can say, listen, this is what it looks like. I don't want you to feel like you are doing a bait and switch necessarily, but do this in a very authentic way. Listen, I'm so glad you saw this result. One of the other companies that also had this result when they added this service was also this. Is this something that you would like for us to explore? Is this something you would like to take some time for me to show you more of? Now's not the time, but maybe we can book a meeting in a week from now or at the end of this week. Yeah, that sounds okay. Awesome. Now we can continue the conversation. Okay. future focusing with our clients, right? If we fail to plan, we plan to fail. And some of our companies that we're dealing with are feeling this right now. They didn't have a plan in place. And not that anybody really planned for this. I don't want you to think about this, but we talked about this as the business contingency plan. In the event something happens that we aren't expecting, do we have a plan in place? Now, it might be too late for some aspects, but here's the other thing is that we want our clients to also feel planned and be prepared to focus on the future. So we want to be able to move that forward. Strategic planning. This was one of the areas that I ended up using to actually grow my business in the 2008 and 2009 recession. When I worked for Xerox, I would call a lot of my clients and I asked them, listen, now's not the time for us to talk about your immediate business needs, but I would love to take an opportunity to talk about where your business is going to be in the next 6 months, a year, 2 years in the future. And let's see if we can put out a plan in place so that when you're ready to buy, you already know what that's going to look like. I was amazed by how many people said, yeah, actually that seems nice, or I really look forward to that. The nice thing about this is by taking out the quote unquote immediate sale, the client feels like there's less pressure to be sold to. And we're actually looking at the opportunities that are far more in advance. The irony is by looking at those far future focus things, it almost always created an opportunity that for them to take some type of impact today in order to see the benefit even sooner than the 6 months or year or 2 years in the future. So some of the things, we start off very future focused with this, right? You know, if they can agree, what we ultimately want to do is like say, listen, I would love to sit down with you and talk about how this is actually going to help you improve your business in the next year or 2 years. Yeah, absolutely, Lynn. It shows that you believe in their success. Absolutely, right? We want them to survive and we want to be a part of not just that survival, but in that thriving capacity. So, you know, by looking at that 2 year plan, it's like, okay, well, where do you want to be, right? What is this going to look like? What are some of the partnerships, the vendorships, the businesses that you need to have in your pocket in order to make this happen? What are some ways that you can automate this? What are some ways that you can, you know, change from manual transactions into different types of transactions? What are some of the right? What do they need to be prepared for? And this gives you an opportunity to kind of take a step back from your current role as a salesperson or role as the vendor of this particular service or solution, and rather take a look at the entire vision and strategic plan. The other nice thing about looking at it much more at a bigger level, the strategic plan or the visionary side, is that you are more likely to get in front of even higher level of clients than ever before. The people that are looking from a strategic and a visionary side are the ones that are more likely to say yes to these opportunities, not from your operational people. So if you've always wanted to get in front of a higher level client, these are the types of conversations that you want to have. And then we start to talk to them about, well, what would it look like there? What are some things that you need to take place? Like, what are some of the things that you need to have in place if we're talking, let's say, 2 years in advance? What are the things you need to have in place a year from now? What are the things that you need to have in place 6 months from now? What are the things that you need to start preparing today? And this is the magic of sales, because automatically this usually means that there's usually something. Now, it's not always going to be the case. And that's the beauty of this, because even if it's not always the case that it is something like, okay, well, this is what we need to look at 6 months in advance, you're already building your funnel for September. Bing, 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 bing. Fantastic. And while everyone else is in that, you know, just that I need to eat, I need to eat, I need to eat phase, you're thinking, okay, let's eat today, but also let's make sure that we have food on the table 6 months and a year from now. And now we're setting ourselves up for that bigger picture. And what does the future hold for their clients? So one of the biggest things that we also focus on in KO Sales U is, what is that third box thinking? Who are our clients, and how can you help your client help their clients connect further? Or how can you help your client connect with even more of their prospects? So going back to some of the previous examples, maybe this is on the panel side, maybe this is on case studies, maybe this is something else. Leverage this as a point, like, listen, when you're featured in this, how will you use this to be able to send to your clients? How can you use this as being an opportunity to be able to connect even greater with your clients. And now they're seeing that this isn't just you being selfish, but rather selfless, because you're ultimately helping me connect with even more of my prospects and my clients going forward. I want you to support them in creating more impact. So this could be, you know, everything from social media, but also how do we also help them to host? Or how are you doing something really well and you help to train them how to do this? This might only be 30 minutes or 45 minutes of your time, but that time is going to pay you back in leaps and bounds. This can also help you to provide, be part of a brainstorming suggestion or session, right? How do you go ahead and collaborate with their internal team? Listen, when was the last time you thought about helping your client's customer? And they said, well, you know, right now we're just in this kill and eat strategy. Like, you know, we're so busy trying to figure out how to survive. I get that. Is it possible to take out an hour just to take a step back and think about the future? It will take less, it'll take away some of the stress because now you know where you want to go. And I'm more than happy to help you out with that. No, we're fine. That's fine. Not a problem, because the other thing you've already done is for those few clients that have said yes to this, you've already started to template some of the questions they need to address, some of the things they need to take a look at. And instead of being part of that session, if they can't have you a part of that session, or they're not willing to have you a part of the session, you can say, listen, I've already come up with some great ideas. In your next internal meeting, I'm going to send you these questions, review them with your team. Can I give you a call in a week or 2 weeks and find out what were some of your thoughts going forward on this? And this gives you an opportunity for you to continue on and think, how do you help in even a bigger ways than possible? Okay. Prospects. Oh, I love this. I've always wanted a reason to reach out. Okay. There's no better time than the present. Listen, if not now, when? You know, and I know that you've probably been looking for that reason to reach out before, but if you haven't been able to find a reason in the past, what is stopping you, or what is that reason going to be like in the future? So why not use this as an opportunity to reach out now? Now, this isn't about going ahead and being salesy, but actually in the ways that we actually do train our students in KO Sales U. How will you help me make more money? I talked about this a little bit more in the previous slides, specifically for clients, but this is even more critical for prospects. And I get it. Some companies are going to be looking to reduce their expenses. That is it. And if that is what you do, like, don't go ahead and try to overcomplicate it at this point in time. If you're looking to reduce your expenses, great. Let's move forward on this. Other companies, though, on the other hand, are looking to increase their revenue. And some of them are actually looking for a great combination for the two. I want to reduce some of the expenses here in order to be able to increase some of the expenses here. I'm no different than a lot of other companies. One of the things we looked at was we were very fortunate. We're actually already doing some line items on a lot of our operating expenses. And some of the things I was looking at is, how do we reduce some of these operating expenses so that we can invest in ways of our companies? Now it's becoming even more critical. There's still companies out there that are wanting to spend money. This is a great opportunity. So ask them if you can help. Can I help you find ways in order to make money, right? Are you open to seeing how this is going to help you increase your revenue, increase your profitability, attract more clients in other industries that you hadn't thought of before? Listen, I'm not asking for a sale right now. All I'm asking for is for an opportunity to be able to brainstorm with you. And if you get nothing out of that, then there was nothing left for you to buy, right? An hour of your time is all I need to help show you how to make more money. Now, this isn't about you showing them. I want to be very clear. This isn't about you making a presentation or providing them a whole bunch of Word documents or PowerPoints and, like, you know, inundating them with a whole bunch of information. This is a webinar, right? You guys came in with the intention of what this was going to be. But if I was to do this with a client, this would be much more of asking questions. What are some ways you're doing this? What are some ways you're doing this? Even use the ideas that you've come up with from this particular presentation, frame them in the form of a question for a client, and get them to answer you. One of the things I say in KO Sales U is, anything you tell the client is up for skepticism. Anything they tell you is their truth. So you may ask them, how many case studies do you already have out there? Well, we have none. Is that a way for you to increase the number of clients that you had, right? Outside of what this current environment is, if you had more case studies, could you get more clients? Yes, absolutely. Okay, great. What's stopping you from doing that? How can I help you facilitate that, right? Is there a way for you to be able to engage a panel of industry experts or vendors that you're already using? Yeah, actually, that's a great idea. I would love to help you put this together. What if we had this, this, and this? Maybe together we can go ahead and fill the room. Oh my goodness, that's so amazing. Everyone else just wants to sell me and you're the only one that's wanting to help me. Oh, isn't that nice, right? Number one, it makes you much more compassionate and thoughtful all the way through. But the other thing is they're more likely to buy from you because now they have seen how you're providing them value outside of just your product or service line. Make it easy for them to just say yes to the meeting. The first thing you need is the meeting. Once you get the meeting, then you can cover all the different topics. But really the biggest thing is be specific in how you're going to help them make more money. Listen, I'm connecting a lot of clients with other clients of theirs through webinars and other types of formats. Can I show you how we're doing this internally? And if it's a great idea, you can use that. Yeah, actually, that's really, what are you trying to sell me? There's nothing to be sold here right now. Right now, I just want to help my community, help my clients, help other people that I've always wanted to do business with and show them how we can ultimately create this. Yeah, that sounds great. Or they're going to say no, but if you don't ask, the answer is no. But don't go in knowing all the answers, okay? The last thing you want to do is, as you're trying to create more meetings, is not just try to tell somebody how they're doing their business wrong, right? What we call this is like, don't call someone's baby ugly, right? Nobody wants to be told that their baby was ugly, especially during a rainstorm, right? You know, your puppy dog is like already pretty ugly. And now that it's a wet dog, like it's even uglier, like congratulations. It's like, okay, well, I'm so glad I showed you my puppy, right? No, don't go in knowing all the answers. Relationships are valuable and will stay valuable regardless of your company or your title. So continue to connect with people that you've met with before, people that aren't even in the current companies that you're trying to target. Maybe these are other relationships. Feel free to mix up your day with a whole bunch of things. We don't always have to be completely laser focused on these are the 100 companies that I need to target, but it could be here's the 100 companies I need to target, and I'm going to take 15 minutes out of every day to call one person that I had a relationship with from a previous life or a previous role or a previous company and just find out how are you feeling. Last week I did that blog post where I talked about the ways you can reach out, right? How are you feeling is a great opener for anybody. Not how are you doing, but how are you feeling? It creates vulnerability and authenticity in the conversation. Be willing to learn. Learn more about those other companies. Learn about where they want to take their business. Learn about what they believe the future is going to be. Get outside of the 6-week timeframe. Get them thinking into 6 months and a year from now. More people will be much more optimistic and future focused that way. Business will be back to where it should be, likely by September. September isn't that far away, and it's a beautiful place to get people to start thinking about it. Be open-minded to wherever the conversation goes. Keep it tailored and focused. There are people that are going to go off in tangents, and that's why having a list of questions prepared will help to keep you focused so that you're not going down rabbit holes and different paths into the abyss that you want to bring them back. And feel free to ask them what else do they need. And be creative with your solutions. Perhaps this is a great time to just go ahead and start bundling offerings. Maybe you have a new service offering. I've given you a lot of things that you can offer for free, but maybe that ends up becoming something that you eventually charge for. Or maybe there's another type of value add you can provide clients. How else can you help them? How else can you help the community? How else can you just help people in general? Is this a teaching moment? Is there ways that you can teach just not even outside your product or service, but teach other companies? Maybe you're a sales director for a company and you contact other sales directors to teach them what you look for in terms of finding great staff. Maybe you're a vice president of a company and you want to teach other junior companies what are some of the financial metrics that you now follow in order to show them. What are some other things outside of your particular product or service that you can teach others? How else can you bring more value to the conversation? 1 + 1 does not always equal 2. Sometimes it equals 3. One of the ways that I was able to create one of the biggest deals in 2009. So while the entire economy went down and I'm at Xerox and we created the biggest deal of the year, was because not only did we create opportunities where we were using technology, both old and new technology, we also told them how we were going to teach their sales staff how to leverage that technology in order to increase their revenues and increase their profits. And then a big thing that we did was we also connected them on a panel that we did for our own clients. So we would often host an annual event. And so part of the negotiation was that, listen, when we host one of our customer appreciation events, we would love to have you on a panel because some of those clients are also going to be your clients. All of that ended up creating more value for the client outside of just the pure transaction. People are looking for more creative solutions, but the only way you're going to find this out is by asking what else will be valuable, what else will be valuable. Be willing to service the ones that your other competitors have forgotten. So right now, a lot of companies are living in this very much survive over thrive type of thing. I just need to make sure my clients are doing well. I just need to make sure that I'm holding onto my base right now. And they're going to be going after typically the biggest ones that they manage. They're going to be thinking about who are my biggest clients, who are the ones that use the most amount of our products and services. And they're going to forget about all the little guys, this is your opportunity to shine, because chances are the little guys have already been forgotten about for a while now. And now when you come in, because you're like, listen, like, you know what, we're here to help in any way, and we're being specific with how we help or how we can help specific clients in the past, they're gonna be like, yeah, you know what, I've been thinking about leaving my current situation for a little while. Now is probably as good of a time as any to make this change or this transition. These are the ones that are going to help you grow your business faster, because the little guys, the ones that haven't been serviced or underserviced for a really long time, are now angry and they are ready to make a change more so than the big guys. So if you're going after competitive situations, don't think about who are the big ones that we want to go after, but who are the tiny ones, and go after the ones that need the help the most. And then go in for those fast transactions. If there's an opportunity for you to see that fast transaction, is there an opportunity for your clients or your prospects to save time, save money, or save energy immediately? If I implement this tomorrow, I can immediately see a result on my bottom line. Go for it. Don't go ahead and beat around the bush. Don't try to say like, oh, well, we have to create all these meetings. Just go in. Are you interested in like saving $20,000 this year, right? Are you interested in completely like not having to do that activity anymore so that you can focus on your clients? Yes. Awesome. Let's make this happen, right? Go in for like the quick opportunity. People want to make fast decisions right now. I don't want to take the time to have to sit down with every single vendor with every single opportunity. There's some that will make sense to this, but there's other ones where like, if I got this off my plate, it would allow me the time to focus on all these other conversations. Maybe you've been having some conversations with somebody and you're like mid sales cycle, right? Why not just try to say like, listen, like, I know we've been having a lot of conversations, but I can tell you today that if you got this implemented, this could potentially save you $10,000. Or what you could end up doing is you could save yourself this extra time so that you can focus on these other areas to grow your business. It doesn't always have to be about time, money savings. It can be about time savings or energy savings, which will then ultimately help me grow my business. How fast can you get them to see those results? And a booked meeting is better than no meeting. So when you have a conversation with somebody, if they tell you that now is not the time, or I'm just not interested right now, still go in for the meeting. I would much rather you have a meeting booked in 3 weeks, 3 months time than having nothing in the calendar. Meetings can always be adjusted or declined, but at least it's in the calendar, whether that is a phone meeting, whether that is a Zoom meeting, or whether that is booking an in-person meeting when the time comes. And if we need to adjust it to be a virtual meeting, that is fine. And if the timing isn't right, or we don't have all the things that we need in place first, we can always adjust it after the fact. All right. Well, thank you so much for being a part of this. For those of you that aren't current students or graduates of our program, I'm going to take a moment just to tell you, you know, when Nabil took our class, what he ended up finding immediately was that we really undervalue the program. He says that he ended up getting so much value from everything that what we got from this. Rob Crooks, right now, I mean, the biggest thing he said, he joined us, 2 years ago, and he said that this was revenue that he was just sitting on. He had no idea how much opportunity there was until after he had taken our program. And if you're sitting there figuring out where you're going to find this next amount of money, now's the time that you want to be able to get started. And finally, we had Cameron, who said, listen, this was like magic or something. This is me today. I am LinkedIn's most influential sales leader to follow, friend of Oprah, although I don't know if she knows that, but I definitely know that. I am Success Magazine's most inspirational blogger. That is my third book there in the corner, Sell More Faster. If you have not downloaded the book yet, I am going to give you the free e-version of the book, the whole book. It's not even just a portion or a free chapter or anything. It is the full book. There you go. Go to that website. There is a form to fill out and you will get the whole PDF version of the book. I am also Startup Canada's most influential sales leader to follow. Our program is 10 weekly sessions with 90 minutes. It's a lot of very base instruction. Listen, right now is the time that you need to be starting to focus on June. If you don't know what your pipeline looks like in June, if you didn't know what your pipeline looked like in June at the beginning of March, and you definitely don't know what your pipeline looks like at the end of June, now is the time to focus on that. I want to give you an opportunity to meet with me, meet with my team. I'm going to give you my personal meeting link here. This will actually book 20 minutes in my calendar with me directly. I want to hear about your business and I want to hear about how I can help you sell more faster. So go ahead and connect with me because I mean, this is what it's about. This is about helping you create more business. And we've had a lot of people, especially over the last couple of weeks, who just want to brainstorm. They just want to say, how can I use this on my business? How can I go ahead and create more sales? That's a 20-minute sales strategy session for that. We're going to be hosting another webinar in 2 weeks' time on Monday, April 6th. We're going to be talking about the 10 questions you need to ask in every single sales meeting. I hope you use the information that you got today to book more meetings, to book more opportunities. And if one of the things I said throughout the entire presentation is how can you go ahead and get those meetings and prepare the questions? I said, prepare the questions. I'm going to give you 10 questions that you should be asking in every single sales meeting. And those are the ones that are going to help to create even more opportunities for you going forward. And because you are now all informal sales you students, what I want to do is say, listen, what is one thing you're going to take away from today? What is one thing that you've gained value from? Who is the client you're going to contact with an idea? Who are those prospects that you're going to call with new ideas? Who are you going to be able to connect with further on this? And that is it for me today. I hope you all found this valuable. I'm already checking out some of the chats. So thank you. Great information. Thank you. Yeah, you are all so very, very welcome. This is what I do. I teach people how to sell more faster in ways that don't feel salesy, in ways that are meaningful and connecting, because people are people and relationships are relationships. And when we connect with more people, the sales will always come. And that's really what I want you to take away from these sessions. I hope you enjoy my little basement fort. We are working on changing this going forward, but you get to see that sometimes it's just not pretty. Sometimes it's not pretty, but it's about the energy. It's about the confidence. It is about how can we help people to be more enthusiastic, more positive, more optimistic, because this too shall pass. And we want to help more people get to where they want to be, where they deserve to be, which is making more money, connecting with more clients, and having more personal relationships going forward. We want to focus on how you can help clients grow and improve. Good job, Luciana. I am so thankful for that. Steven, your positivity is fantastic. Yes, be positive, right? People want to hear that. And when you call someone up and you're like, hey, how are you feeling today? Like, the sun is beautiful. It is shining. It is beautiful. It's warm out. Like, remember, there's so many things to be grateful for. And if you haven't even taken the time to like sit down and say what you're grateful for, what are the three things that you're grateful for today? Take a moment and do that at bare minimum, because there's a lot of things that we should all be thankful for. Yeah, good job, John. Thank you so much for your comments as well. I'm going to keep the chat open for a few more minutes. That is it. I don't have anything more for you. But if you have any questions or anything that you want to ask, go ahead and ask them. I'm going to stay on for a few more minutes. Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. Yeah, how you like the idea of working. Yeah, absolutely, right? Like, this is a great information gathering time. Like, if you don't know anything about your clients or your prospects, like, now's the time to find out about them. It comes across as non-salesy, and it gets you a greater opportunity to find out behind their scenes. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Thank you all. Have a great day. Enjoy it. Enjoy this Monday. It's a new week, right? Hopefully you've all had lots of rest. And if you haven't, take some personal time for yourself. Take some time to say, you know what? It has to be a personal day. For most of us who are now working from home, one of the things I've learned about working from home is you have to set your own schedule and what works for you. And if that means that you have to take a lunchtime dog walk, and if that means that you have to dress up to show up, even if you're working out of a basement with a sheet behind you in a makeshift tent, you do that. You do you. Ali, yes, it will be mailed out. Zoom's been taking a little bit longer to render our recording, so it'll probably be closer to 48 to 72 hours, unfortunately. But it is what it is. So yes, it will be mailed out. Absolutely. And like what I said on the thing, we actually take it and we're going to be turning it later on into a blog post as well. We have a lot of content that we can create. If we don't understand what will make our clients successful, get to the personal level of the challenges. If we don't understand what will make our clients successful. Oh, that's your takeaway, John? Yeah, yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Yeah, yeah. I love it. Yeah, yeah. People are people, right? Nobody wants to be sold to. Okay. Bye-bye for now then, everybody. Have a great day. I hope to see you in a couple weeks. On Thursday, we're going to be doing sales role plays. That's free for as long as we're all having social isolation, because I want you to be socially isolated, but doesn't mean you have to go into social isolation, but doesn't mean you have to be socially isolated. So let's go ahead and make more connections. Yeah, see you on Thursday. Absolutely. Thank you.